Hi, I'm Andrea Johnstone. I'm going to talk to you today about some technologies that EpiCypher is developing to improve our understanding of chromatin regulation and enable drug discovery approaches for epigenetic drug targets. And in particular, I'm going to highlight how these approaches can be useful for cancer research. So first, for those who might want a little refresher course on epigenetics, recall that DNA in the nucleus is packaged in the form of nucleosomes, the basic repeating unit of chromatin. And these nucleosomes consist of 147 base pairs of DNA wrapped around an octamer of four core histone proteins. And this DNA can be methylated and the histones themselves can be post-translationally modified through a variety of different types of modifications that ultimately coordinate to regulate gene expression throughout development and in response to various external stimuli. Unfortunately, these epigenetic processes can go awry and contribute to the pathophysiology of various diseases, including cancer. So there's an immense amount of interest in developing drugs that target the enzymes that mediate the addition, the interpretation, and the removal of these epigenetic marks, the so-called writer, reader, and eraser enzymes, as well as targeting chromatin remodelers and transcription factors that are coordinating the cellular response to this epigenetic code in order to mediate changes in chromatin accessibility and gene transcription. And so in order to advance basic research and drug development for epigenetics, this relies critically on the availability of robust technologies that are capable of precisely mapping the localization in the genome of these epigenetic marks and their associated signaling pathways, so we can start to understand how these are changed in development and disease. And a very popular approach for doing this has been ChIP-seq, or chromatin immunoprecipitation. And undoubtedly, this approach has been transformational in improving our understanding of chromatin regulation. However, it's plagued by a variety of problems, which essentially boil down to this. In ChIP, you're lysing the cells, releasing your chromatin into solution, fragmenting it, and then tasking an antibody with specifically recovering only the target of interest, washing away all the background, all the off targets. And this requires very stringent washes and very, very deep sequencing in order to adequately resolve the signal from the background noise. So at the end of the day, even with those extensive washes and deep sequencing, the data quality is not ideal. The approach is overall very low throughput, limiting its applications specifically for clinical development, and the approach is quite expensive as well. So EpiCypher is developing a novel approach called CUT&RUN, which was originally developed by Uli Limley and Steve Hennikoff Labs. And we've now commercialized this under our CUTANA umbrella platform technology for genomic mapping assays. CUT&RUN has several distinct advantages over ChIP, in particular, a requirement for lower numbers of starting cells. So in ChIP, typically you need millions of cells, but with CUT&RUN, you can go down to just a few thousand cells. And there are several unique aspects of the workflow that enable you to achieve very high resolution at reduced sequencing depth. And that's because in CUT&RUN, you're taking native cells, immobilizing them, permeabilizing them, diffusing in an antibody to your target of interest, either a histone PTM or a chromatin-associated protein. And then you're diffusing in this immunotethered enzyme, in this case, protein AG conjugated to micrococcal nuclease. So the protein AG will go in and bind your antibody of interest. The micrococcal nuclease will then specifically cleave the target DNA that's proximal to wherever your antibody is bound on chromatin. And what this means is that only your target complexes diffuse out into solution. You've left all your background, all your off targets sequestered in the cell, unlike in ChIP, where you're trying to fish out your target and immunoprecipitate it and isolate it from those off targets. And so because only your target of interest is out in solution, it's easy to collect this and achieve very high resolution at tenfold reduced sequencing depth. And this means that your experimental throughput now is quite high. The workflow is relatively straightforward. It's easily amenable to automation as well. Just as a side note here, we're also developing a sister technology, cut and tag, which is really uniquely suited for ultra low input applications, so potentially down to single cells. But for the vast majority of research applications, we recommend cut and run as the go-to approach, as it's incredibly robust And I'll highlight a few examples of that now. So here's what the actual data looks like. So these are sequencing reads for two different marks, H3K4 trimethyl, a mark of active gene promoters, and K27 trimethyl, a more broadly dispersed mark of repressed genes. And what you can see is the sequencing reads aligned to the human genome for both ChIP-seq in gray and cut-and-run in blue. And then I'd like to call your attention to the sequencing depth here for each sample. So in ChIP, you need to use 30 to 40 million reads in order to resolve these peaks. However, in cut-and-run, which is 3 to 4 million reads, you can see the data quality looks very similar. And in fact, if you use an unbiased measure of signal-to-noise, which we quantify using something called a FRIP score by measuring the fraction of reads, which happen to be localized within peaks as opposed to reads which are dispersed over the background. And what you can see is that these FRIP scores are much higher in the cut and run data compared to ChIP-seq, even at tenfold reduced sequencing depth. So this shows that cut and run can be used to profile these widely studied histone modification marks. However, one question that comes up, because cut and run relies on the ability of micrococcal nuclease to access DNA in order to cleave out those target fragments, can cut and run access really deeply condensed regions of chromatin that are quite inaccessible because they're repressing genes? And so we set out to answer this question by profiling marks of constitutive heterochromatin, these highly compressed regions of chromatin, which are typically marked by H3K9 di and trimethylation. And what you see is that when we do cut and run for these marks, we see these beautiful broad megabase domain peaks that are consistent with constitutive heterochromatin. And we applied cut and run for these marks in collaboration with Ari Melnick's lab at Weill Cornell in order to help them address their research question, trying to understand the function of a linker histone protein, histone H1, which is known to contain a variety of mutations that are prevalent in B cell lymphomas. They're trying to understand the function of this protein by creating mouse with a knockout of histone H1. And so using cut and run, what they're able to show is that when you specifically look at chromatin compartments that are decompacted in response to histone H1 knockouts, so that's shown here on the right. These are regions of chromatin that are being decompressed. What you see in these regions is a specific loss of H3K9 di and trimethyl cut and run peaks. And so this is a small part of a broader study that was published in Nature, where the overall conclusions were that a deficiency in H1 causes a reprogramming of the epigenetic state, which is associated with a reactivation of normally repressed stem cell genes and also associated with an increase in lymphomagenesis. So together, these studies show that cut and run is really well adapted to profile histone PTMs, but what about transiently interacting chromatin-associated proteins? And one example of chromatin-interacting proteins is chromatin remodelers. These are proteins that are very widely studied in cancer research, in part because 20% of all cancers contain a mutation within one particular class of these chromatin remodelers, the SWI/SNF family members. However, it's very difficult to study these chromatin remodeling proteins using genomic mapping approaches, in part because they're huge complexes. So what epitope do you target? But more importantly, because these interact very transiently with chromatin. These are cycling ATPases. So they touch down transiently, rearrange chromatin to make it more accessible, and then they're off. In addition to that, they anchor onto chromatin using very labile histone modifications such as lysine acetylation. So there are ways to stabilize the interaction of these chromatin remodelers by using very heavy cross-linking conditions. However, this has the unintended consequence of negatively impacting your signal to noise. And so this is an example of what typical data looks like when profiling SMARCA4, a SWI/SNF chromatin remodeler. And what you can see is that it's very hard to tell exactly where it's mapping on the genome. There's quite a bit of background, but using cut and run, we see this very precise localization right at gene promoters that overlay with known signaling pathways, as you would expect. And in fact, we've been able to show that using cut and run, we can profile all four major families of chromatin remodeling proteins. And so what's shown here are heat maps of cut and run signal in red compared to background in blue at annotated transcription start sites. And what you can see is that when we do cut and run for all four major families of chromatin remodelers, we're able to see an enrichment of these targets at transcription start sites. And we're confident that this enrichment is recapitulating the known biology of these targets. So as an example of this, we looked at SMARCA4 peaks, again, the Y-SNF ATPase domain, ATPase subunit rather. And we asked, does this co-localize with known binding pathways? In this case, BRD4, which has been reported in the literature as a known binding partner of SMARCA4. And what we see is that there is indeed a large degree of overlap in SMARCA4 peaks with BRD4, as you would expect. Again, indicating that we're successfully able to do cut and run for these targets. So you can do cut and run for high value drug targets, but can you actually measure drug responses using cut and run? And so this heat map here is showing breast cancer cells treated with either vehicle or estradiol. And what you see is after treatment, there's a very robust recruitment of estrogen receptor alpha to chromatin, as well as the nuclear receptor co-activator SARC3. So cut and run can be used to profile drug responses, and this has particular applications to clinical research, where in a lot of times your starting cell numbers are very limited. And so you really need to be able to do genomic mapping with very low starting cell numbers. And so this is an example of BRD4, which we've done this for some other targets as well, and we've shown that you can go down to as low as 5,000 cells using the standard cut and run protocol. However, I just want to note that as you start to drop the cell numbers, as you start to try to monitor drug responses and quantitate those changes, as you start to potentially integrate cut and run with clinical drug discovery pipelines, there becomes an exceptionally critical need to use defined controls to be able to monitor your samples and standardize your results. And so we always use positive and negative control antibodies, but it's even better to use a defined control that you're adding to every reaction that you're using to monitor the cut and run reaction. And EpiCypher is a pioneer of recombinant nucleosome technology. So we've developed and commercialized over 100 different types of recombinant nucleosomes. And one trick that we can do is wrap our nucleosomes with unique sequences of DNA, these DNA barcodes. And this enables us to spike in these nucleosomes early into the cut and run workflow. They're carried alongside the sample chromatin through all the steps in the workflow. And at the end of the day, we can distinguish our spike-ins from the sample chromatin using these unique barcodes. So these serve as an experimental control. It tells you that your experiment worked. It lets you flag samples that maybe didn't work and use it to troubleshoot if needed. Also, because these are DNA barcoded and we have such a diversity of nucleosomes, we can create rational panel sets with both on and off-target epitopes to help study histone PTMs, epitope tagged proteins, and transcription factors. And because these spike-ins contain a mix of on and off targets, we can use this to monitor antibody specificity. It also has the added advantage of being able to quantitatively standardize your results and compare across samples. So specifically looking at the ability of these controls to monitor antibody specificity, we've tackled this problem in earnest as it relates to ChIP-seq. So using the same spiking control technology, we profiled hundreds of different antibodies, and we found that unfortunately, the vast majority of them are not fit for purpose. And this is true even when you look at highly cited antibodies in the field. And all this data is freely accessible at chromatinantibodies.com. We're gearing up to publish these results. But gearing up to translate the spike and control technology from ChIP-seq to cut and run, we really want to find what are the best in class antibodies, because the antibodies are such a critical component of the cut and run workflow. And we've made huge progress on this front already. So here's a representative heat map showing some of the best to date antibodies we found to these widely studied histone methylation marks, where you can see that each antibody is specifically recovering its target nucleosome and not cross-reacting outside of that. So as you can see, there's still some work being done here to identify good antibodies, particularly particularly for H4K20 monomethylation. We're also moving this technology forward to lysine acetylation and chromatin-associated proteins as well. So feel free to contact us for up-to-date recommendations and help get started using these highly validated reagents to advance your cancer research. So that was a lot of information in a very short period of time. So I'll just leave you with a summary of how does cut-and-run compare to CHIP. There's some very specific advantages, including less required cells, dramatically reduced sequencing depth, which enables you to do higher throughput studies at lower cost. For cancer research, you can use this approach to study histone PTMs, chromatin-associated proteins, including high-value drug targets like chromatin remodelers, and define and drill down into drug mechanism of action and dose responses. Most of the data I showed you today was using cell lines, but we've also used cut-and-run in primary cells, FACS-sorted cells, tissues, and clinical samples with success. And so if you're interested to get started, we supply all the key reagents, including that PAG MNase, and other reagents needed to do this entire workflow. We also publish optimized protocols directly from our genomics experts, and we offer kits that support the workflow from cells all the way to DNA. We're gearing up to launch those nucleosome spiking controls that I told you about, as well as library preparation kits. And we also have services that are currently in soft launch mode, but will be available soon. And so for general inquiries, feel free to contact info@epicypher.com. You can also contact me directly at ajohnstone@epicypher.com. And lastly, I would just want to thank the whole EpiCypher team, this wonderful group of people. Every one of them really contributed to the data that I showed you today. And lastly, I just want to thank AACR for the opportunity to present. Thanks.